So, if you know me at all, it will come as no surprise that I'm going to talk to you about worship this morning. And if you've been around Hope Church for a little while, you'll know that one of our core kind of values, if you like, one of the things that we prize and treasure is our worship. And I guess it's something that we haven't spoken about much from the front. We've talked on lots of things which impinge on our worship, but we've not really talked a great deal about worship itself. And so this morning I want to try and unwrap a few bits and pieces and hopefully give you just a bit of a deeper understanding of what it is we're doing when we're together as we worship, and also in our personal lives as well. And as a worship leader in this house, and as I'm very grateful to the leadership here who have given a real space for worship. They've encouraged an environment where true, no-holds-barred worship is central to our existence, really. They've been prepared to tolerate the kind of warts and imperfections that come in the style of worship that we have, but knowing that we're coming into a place where we're creating space for God to come in, for the Holy Spirit to come and land among us. And just so blessed that we're able to kind of partner with those moments and steward what God does as he comes among us, and rather than cutting across it and whatever. So I just love to be in this house. I salute the leadership here. We've been brave in pursuing that. So many places, worship has become the warm-up for the preacher or so many other things. And here, it's so good to know that there's not that agenda, that it's for God and for him to come and land and be among. So, let's see where we are, yes. So, I guess when we talk about worship in the church, we often think initially about, you know, what we do on a Sunday morning. But what we do on a Sunday morning really comes out of something in our personal lives. And so, I want to talk about three things this morning. I want to begin just by thinking about, actually, why is it that we worship? What's worship all about? I then want to talk a little bit about the personal intimacy with God. And just in our worship this morning, we just came into that lovely place of him connecting with us and that closeness of him. So I want to talk a bit about that and how we can develop that in our lives. And then I'm going to come on at the end, hopefully, if time doesn't run out, and talk a wee bit about corporate worship as well. So I thought I'd begin actually by telling you a little bit of my story in worship, because that will probably give you a sense of my heart and where I've come from. I think that helps us just to connect with what I'm going to say as well. So, I mean, I grew up in a Christian home, born 50-something years ago now, and my parents were part of a Pentecostal church, and my grandparents were also Pentecostal. So my grandfather knew some of the kind of Pentecostal fathers, Willie Burton and Smith Wigglesworth and some of these guys. And so I came from that heritage, and I'm so blessed that I had this family praying over my life. And I guess I made a kind of an early commitment to Christ, probably in my late primary years in a tent crusade, and I put my hand up and responded in a meeting. But I guess it wasn't until I was in my mid-teens in the late 70s when I really put that into practice, and actually, I guess, said, okay, God, this is it. We're going to go for this. And so it was an exciting time in the church. It was a time when God was really beginning to break out. What we call the charismatic movement was in its infancy. And at the time, I played a bit of guitar, and naturally, I kind of slid into being involved in worship right in those early days. I guess it was pretty simple stuff, but we were exploring something new. And I remember going to a Bible week, a big conference, and just being kind of enthralled by this worship of thousands of people together and pouring their hearts out to God. It was at that time God began to introduce me to this whole idea of encounter with him. I got saved and filled with the Spirit. Spirit very soon after. And what was happening was really in the local Anglican church at the time. They had a Sunday evening meeting and a lot of amazing speakers coming, guys who were quite prominent, I guess, in what was happening among the charismatic movement. And I remember God just breaking in on me again and again, being completely splatted in the Spirit on the altar, behind the altar in this Anglican church, and being carried to the car because I couldn't walk. But in those times, there was this just sense of encounter with God and Him gripping me, and something in my life that has never let go, really. And as I grew in different places, I've just been incredibly blessed to be with worship leaders who exemplified what it was to lead God's people in worship, who carried this thing with such reverent hearts. And through Youth for Christ, I was able to work with a lot of guys who were kind of prominent in worship leading, Graham Kendrick and Dave Bilber and various people. And it was just a real privilege to have these guys just drip wee bits and pieces into me as I went through. And God continued to encounter me through that time. And I think particularly in the early 90s, I guess it was the Toronto Blessing, and God again broke out, I guess in a similar way to what we're seeing now, just real joy in the Spirit and crazy drunken times. And it was just amazing. But I think the church in the UK, we were too British, is the honest truth. And we stepped back, and we never really stepped into the fullness of all that God had for us at that time, I really believe. But I'm so glad that God's God of a second chance. And so just good to be part of this church, connected to churches who pursue God's presence, who have this just real desire to see God break out, for God's kingdom to be established, and for us to influence the world around us. And as I've said, so worship is really core to what we do. And I've heard it said many times that worship, this modern worship, is self-indulgent, it's kind of inward looking, it's all kinds of different things. But I don't believe that's true. I believe that worship is actually the highest calling that we have. I'm not alone in that. You can go back into the 1600s. There's a thing called the Westminster Greater Catechism, which was kind of a declaration of faith. And in that it asks, what's the chief and highest end of man? And the resounding response is to glorify God and fully enjoy Him forever. Doesn't that just blow you away? That's 400 years ago. These guys have picked up on this thing that this is what God has created us for, to glorify Him and fully enjoy Him forever. It says in Ephesians 1, verse 11 and 12, in Him we were chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of Him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of His will, in order that we, who were first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of His glory. That's our purpose. We're for the praise of His glory. We're chosen to glorify God first and foremost. And so that's why I love so much being part of this family, where we prize that high calling that we have. Ecclesiastes 3 tells us that He set eternity in the hearts of men. It's one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It blows me away every time. We're designed with this kind of inbuilt homing beacon for the eternal realms. There's something that's inside of us that's calibrated for the heavenly places. And when we don't know God, actually this leaves us really frustrated and empty and searching for something to connect to that actually fulfills that longing. But when we do connect with God, when we tune into that heavenly frequency, we find that depth of encounter, a connection with God, and a world of delight in His presence. It's what we're created for, church. And Jesus also taught us that worship's a priority. In the Lord's Prayer, He's telling us how to pray, and He starts out, our Father in heaven, we're recognizing who He is. Hallowed be Your name. That place of worship, again, it's what comes first. So above all other things, we need to prioritize worship. It goes on down the list, give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our sins. These are all secondary to us giving our hearts to him in worship. I want to read you a wee excerpt from a book which really shaped my life as a worshipper, by a guy called A.W. Tozer. It's called Worship, the Missing Jewel of the Evangelical Church. It's only about 25, 30 pages long, tiny wee book, but this guy knew what it was to worship. He was really a prophetic guy, pulled something really into a time when there was not much of this happening. He was ministered in the 40s, 50s, early 60s. I later discovered he actually died on the day I was born. How about that? But I remember as a young Christian hearing a guy called Alan Redpath, who some of you may have heard of. He was a great teacher, part of what was, I guess, referred to as the holiness movement. Just a really reverent guy, and he really impacted my heart. But he told a story of meeting Tozer. He was over in the States and was visiting with his church, I think. And Tozer invited him to go and pray with him in the morning down by the lake where they were staying. So he arrived at the time when Tozer had said, and he got there, and Tozer was already there on his knees and worshipping. And Alan Redpath said he was just completely unable to go and join him. There was such a sense of presence of God, and he was just transfixed. It was like Moses at the burning bush. He had that bush. He had that sense of the holy place and a holy moment. So there are some things in Tozer's teaching that you kind of think, well, maybe with our current understanding, maybe not. But when it comes to worship and knowing God, he's my hero, shall we say. So I just want to read, he's defining worship. He says, I want to define worship, and here is, I want to be dogmatic. Worship means to feel in the heart. That's first, feel it in the heart. Now, I happen to belong to a segment of the Church of Christ on Earth that's not afraid of the word feeling. We went through a long deep freeze period at the turn of the century when people talked about naked faith. They wanted to hang us out there like a raccoon skin drying on the door. And so I said, now, don't believe in feeling, brother. We don't believe in feeling. The only man who went by feeling was led astray. That was Isaac when he felt Jacob's arms and thought it was Esau. But they forgot the woman who felt in her body that she was healed. Remember that. A person that merely goes through the form and doesn't feel anything is not worshipping. Worship also means to express in some appropriate manner what you feel. Now, expressing in some appropriate manner doesn't mean that we will always express it in the same way all the time. And that's been one of the great freeing things in this house, that it doesn't matter what it looks like. It's your own personal response to God. Yeah, so it doesn't mean that you'll always express your worship in the same manner, but it does mean that it will be expressed in some manner. And what will be expressed? A humbling but delightful sense of admiring awe and astonished wonder. It's delightful to worship God, but it's also a humbling thing, and the man who's never been humbled in the presence of God will never be a worshipper of God at all. Yeah. I love this man. He just has this reverence for God, and clearly he was drawing on something from heaven. So worship is something for us to experience and express. We give glory to an awesome God and a loving Father. And Scripture backs us up on this as well. It's not just Tozer's thinking and writing. In John 4:23, verses that we really know very well, Jesus said, yet a time's coming and it's now come when the true worshippers will worship in spirit and in truth, for they're the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. Worship's a spiritual activity, first and foremost. It's something that connects our spirits with the Spirit of God. But I want to home in just briefly on the word truth here, because I've heard it taught a lot that this truth is about what we know and doing the right thing and saying the right thing. But actually the word truth here is not about head knowledge, but about experiential knowledge. So we worship in our spirit, in spirit, and our spirit connects with the Holy Spirit, and that results in our experience of him. That's, to me, is mind-blowing. also notice that the Father isn't seeking worship, but he's seeking worshippers. It's us that he's after. He's about relationship and he's about connection. It's not an empty act of worship done because we grudgingly feel that he deserves it and he's worthy of it, but it's something that comes out of heart connection with him. So that kind of leads me in to the second thing I wanted to talk about, and that's a bit about personal intimacy. So right from the beginning, God's purpose was for intimacy with men. With Adam and Eve, he would come and kind of glean that he would walk with them in the garden in the evening. And even after the fall came, the fall occurred, he still came and he sought them out. But they hid with guilt, fear and shame overtaking them. And the relationship between God and man was clouded. And as we look through the Old Testament, there are some guys who still make this connection. We have Abraham, who was described as a friend of God, and he had that face-to-face relationship with God. We read about Moses, who met God face-to-face in Sinai and went up on the mountain and worshipped in the cloud, and he came down, and his face was shining with the glory of God. And we see David, I guess, really our prototypical worshipper, who had this intimate relationship as a shepherd on the hillside, learning just to fellowship with God and to know his protection and his closeness there. And he was a remarkable man. He prophetically pulled something akin to New Testament worship, New Covenant worship, into Old Testament times. The tabernacle was a picture, really, of worship for us. And it's one of the reasons, I think, why there isn't actually a great deal about worship in the New Testament when you look at it. But these guys weren't the norm. There was a separation. There was a need for blood sacrifices. And it wasn't really till Jesus came that that problem was dealt with. That separation was dealt with. And the possibility of intimacy with the Father is restored. But intimacy doesn't just happen. Like all relationships, it's something that takes time, effort, investment. I married Lydia 31 years ago, but the day we got married didn't signal the final level of our intimacy. We've shared life together for more than 3 decades. We've raised a family together. We've faced cancer together. We've rejoiced as we've seen our kids flourish. We've faced all kinds of situations together. And we're so much more deeply connected than we were on the day we got married. And our lives are irrevocably intertwined. It talks about two becoming one, and that's what happens. And it's the same in the relationship with God as well. Bill Johnson talks about making our own personal history with God. And he's talking about this intimacy as we walk closely with him, sharing life's journey with him, turning our affections to him, developing that depth of relationship with him. And it isn't something that happens instantly. It's something we invest in. It's something we make a choice to pursue. And the history of God that we develop as we acknowledge him in all the things we do is like an anchor for us in our lives. It keeps us grounded. It keeps us safe. It keeps us in that tender place with him. It's like a deposit in the bank of heaven, if you like. It's our investment in that relationship. And so this is kind of, we need to develop this lifestyle of worship that is constantly involving God in what we do, acknowledging God in what we do. So what does this look like? Well, I've got 5 headings. The first one is that true worship is born out of relationship. So we kind of touched on this already. In John's Gospel, Jesus says that we worship what we know. It's not some distant, far-off God. He was talking to the Samaritan woman at the well. But we worship what we know. We've had a great deal of teaching over the past few years on our father-son relationship. We talked about the prodigal son, and the father who loves unconditionally. And that's no accident. That really underpins so much of our worship. We need to understand and grasp and allow God just to drill that into our spirits. intimacy with God is the key starting point for our worship. And even the Greek word in the New Testament used for worship means a kiss, to kiss towards. So it's about affection and it's about intimacy. And if we consistently turn our affections to him, he will manifest himself to us. Peter, 1 Peter 5 says, if you draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. We just need to be constantly in our day-to-day lives drawing near to him. When you get up, when you go to sleep, when you go for a coffee, when you go to work, whatever it is, just involving him in every area of our lives. And that's how we begin to develop that intimacy. Second thing is that true worship is intentional. Intentionality is a word we hear a great deal in our circle at the moment. And basically, it means we're doing something with purpose, not just drifting along and hoping that something will happen. And certainly true in the sphere of worship, whether we're worship leaders, whether we're whoever we are in the body, we need to make good choices to worship well. We need to actively ready ourselves, put ourselves in a place where God can come and ignite our offering. So I want to encourage you, personally press in for more of what God has for you. Personally press in for more of that intimacy with him. You know, here at Hope we've got some remarkable anointed men and women who lead us in worship, who teach us and so on. And it's very easy to ride on the coattails of their anointing. You know, we have guys who lead us into the heavenly places week after week. And it's amazing. But there's so much more for us than just simply coming in on a Sunday, getting that great sense of God's presence. God wants us to experience that day after day in the midst of all that we're doing. And as I say, that takes being intentional about it. It sometimes means changing your mindset and just starting to prioritize, stepping aside for a few moments, giving God glory, or whatever it takes. We need to learn to give offerings of worship both in adversity and in the place of success as well. I think we're often at our most vulnerable when we're successful. You look at Elijah in the Old Testament, this amazing showdown with the prophets of Baal, his victory, God sends down fire, all the rest of it. And the next thing we read, he's out in the desert, depressed, and God, what's going on? Everybody hates me. And so we need to be acknowledging God, both in the success and the failure. So making a history with God requires discipline sometimes, not a slavish, I've got to do this, but something that's born out of God. I want to be with you. Worship is the pursuit of God and of his presence. Now, true worship is also costly at times. It doesn't come cheaply. There's a personal cost as we pursue him. As a worship leader, there have been many times when I've been due to lead worship on a Sunday morning and something awful has happened and it's the last thing I want to do. But sometimes there's that time you have to lay down and pay a cost. There's a great story in 2 Samuel 24 about David and Israel's in the middle of this plague and so on, and it's not looking good. And the prophet says to David, go and build an altar to the Lord on this guy's threshing floor. So David goes to him and says, can I buy your threshing floor? And Arunah was the guy, and he says, no, you can have it for nothing. On you go. You use it. But David replied to him, no, I insist on paying you for it. I will not sacrifice to the Lord my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing. And I think we have a very throwaway culture. Many words come cheap, and I think when we're worshipping, let's not be people who just throw our words away cheaply, but let's give something that's precious. Let's give something that costs our hearts something. So David was aware that we needed to give something that cost him. Again, in John 12, verses 1 to 7, again we see